You don't call it. Well, nice. Yes, good to see you all. Rain stopped for a little while. We need to get a little bit breezy still. That's good. As you see, it's myself leading this morning and Roger taking the service this evening. And there will be communion as part of that service. Tuesday, 7 p.m. prayer meeting at Malcolm's and Doreen's. We had a good time of fellowship. Fellowship and prayer last Tuesday, didn't we? Yeah. And so we meet again this week. And then next Sunday, the 13th of August, it's Carl in the morning, and he tells me you can't have enough of him, so it's going to be Carl as well in the evening, reading that service. Streets for prayer. This month it says, pray for the street you live in, or your neighbours. UEC churches let us pray for our sister churches over August. So this week it's Cressy, Dorset, and Eastwood. I think we're running through the whole lot. And missionary focus is we pray for the beach missions taking place over August, being run by United Beach Missions. And there's a list of places, I'm not sure I know where exactly all of them are, but we'll ask for, through our prayers, God's blessing on those events. And Daphne's funeral will be at the crematorium on August the 24th, and it's thought it's 3 p.m, but we'll get that confirmed before the time. So 24th of August, Daphne's funeral. Let's just pray for the offerings. Heavenly Father, yes, your goodness never ceases, and we are thankful that you are the faithful God, our God. And all those monetary gifts are given is even as an act of worship. Lord, bless them, we pray. For that in your service through the church here, or in the work of missionaries, Jeremy Nash and his wife in Africa, and Tim and Susanna Gretchen. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Should perhaps just say, me and Sarah Jane will not be around for the next two Sundays. And so it's an all August prayer. I'm sure you'll get on all right. And I can ask you how you got on when I come back. Right. Some verses from Scripture from Psalm 89. The heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness too, in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. O Lord, God Almighty, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. You rule over the surging sea. When the waves mount up, you still will. The heavens are yours, and yours also the earth. You founded the world and all that is in it. You created the north and the south. Tabor and Hermon sing for joy at your name. Your arm is endued with power. Your hand is strong. Your right hand is exalted. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. Blessed are those who have learned to acclaim you, who walk in the light of your presence, O Lord. Let's sing, Jesus is Lord, creation's voice proclaimed.
See if this works.
Tower Bridge. Paul's good thing. You recognise these things.
Yeah.
Why do you recognise them?
Because it's still there.
Been there.
That's the bridge.
One of the bridges across the Thames. I think it's London Bridge. You've got the old bit, and the new bit is built inside of it. So it's quite dated shot. It's probably over 50 years ago, these pictures. Now, anybody know where that is?
It's in Shoebridge.
Good try, but no. That's a, well, it would have been UEC that day, chapel in Ramsden Heath. Now, it probably wasn't long after that that the chapel closed, but there was actually a meeting there for the rest of the city field. Yeah. My family, or mum particularly, had a lot of relations in Ramsden Heath. I know nothing of it really, but there you go. Now, well, let's think. Is there one more? Oh, there's.
59 St. Mary's Road.
That is 59 St. Mary's Road, where I grew up. So, my home. But, yeah, it means something to me. I see it's still in its green phase, green paintwork of green. Blue paintwork phase. No, it doesn't, it's not too clear there, is it? I'm looking at the screen here, which is a lot more clearer. Now I've got some people. This is a. Now, it's. You won't know, but do you know who that person is there? You probably don't know. No? That's Jill. Or Myrtle, as we all knew her then, believe it or not. That's the youngster is. You're right, my niece, Jenny. I think that's the back of my head there as well. Now, it's not the best picture that's come out, and a head full of hair might confuse you. So that's my brother. My brother Phil. As I say, this is probably the late 60s. So he's probably in his 20s still. Right, and let's see who's next. Oh. That is me. So, what I'm standing on a stool in the garden for, I do not know. But there we go. And that's my mum. And I put another one in for a few hours. That's me and mum. But they probably don't mean, or you don't recognise any of those people on there, apart from one. But I do, because they mean something to me. And we might come back to that later. Let's sing, "We Believe in God the Father, Maker of the Universe, and in Christ, His Son, our Saviour, come to us by virgin birth."
Thank you. 6 and it's on page 1009 in your church Bible. Jesus walks on water. Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. After leaving them, he went up on a mountainside to pray. Later that night, the boat was in the middle of the lake, and he was alone on the land. He saw the disciples straining at the oars because the wind was against them. Shortly before dawn, he went out to them, walking on the lake. He was about to pass them, but when they saw him walking on the lake, they thought he was a ghost. They cried out, because they all saw him and were terrified. Immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." Then he climbed into the boat with them, and the wind died down. They were completely amazed, for they had not understood about the loaves. Their hearts were hardened. When they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret and anchored there. As soon as they got out of the boat, people recognized Jesus. They ran throughout that whole region and carried those who were ill on mats to wherever they were that he was. And wherever he went, into villages, towns or countryside, they placed those who were ill in the marketplaces. They begged him to let them touch even the edge of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. It's the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to this time of prayer, time for intercessory prayer, as we bring petitions and people to you, situations to you in prayer. Because you are a God who is interested, you are a God who listens and hears and who answers prayer. We thank you for this truth. Heavenly Father, we do pray for those who we know who are unwell. We heard what people did in Bible times when Jesus came to the region. The people were brought to Jesus and he healed them in his compassion. Heavenly Father, we would do the same, no doubt. Lord, we do bring loved ones, friends, family to you in prayer. Names are going through our heads at this time, and you can hear those names. Lord, meet the needs. If it's through us, then help us to help the needs. If it's through hospitals, help them to meet the needs. Lord, we bring them to you in prayer. We think of world situations. We know of wars and rumours of wars. Things quiet down, it would appear in one place and then would start up in another. We hear of events in Niger. We still think of the Ukraine-Russia war, the somewhat stalemate, somewhat escalation, and the troubles there. Lord, we would pray for your intervention on men's hearts. Sometimes we don't know how to pray. Pray for our land here. And if we were to judge what say is turned away from you in so many ways. But Lord, you have been a good God to this country. And in your mercy. But may there be that revival, that gospel still going out through the land, that may be preached and souls may still be saved. Bless churches throughout the land. Bless the beach missions at this time, where again your seed, your truth, your love is shared through those activities. May those who hear take it in, and may you give the increase, Heavenly Father. We also think of the persecuted church, as it's termed, those who don't have the freedoms that we perhaps take for granted. Lord, be very near to them. Be very close to them. Be the God that tells them and assures them to take courage and not to be afraid. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Got a couple of choruses, type ones now. Faithful one, still unchanging, and then Jesus' name above all names. We'll probably do them both twice. Thank you. I'm going to take you back to school. I don't know if that's a good thing, good memories or bad memories. But I heard this term used on the radio one day, compare and contrast. And I thought, yes, that could be useful to go with what I knew perhaps would be my next mark study. At school, you may have been asked to compare and contrast. Awesome. You might be able to put two pieces of prose, poems, or books, write an essay on their similarities and differences. It could be the presentation of the topic, writing style, were they saying the same thing, but in different ways, and your teacher wanted you to bring that out. If not during English, maybe science. Compare and contrast, and I've written down, this might not be safe, I'm not sure, but you might need your goggles and your gloves and your whatever. How different metals say react in different chemicals or solutions, it might be. But saying that, we have many teachers, or old teachers, or former teachers, I should say. Now, I should have asked them to explain the term compare and contrast, or asked if they ever used it as a tool for learning. Apples and oranges. Both round, aren't they? Both fruit. You can eat the skin of an apple. We don't eat the skin of an orange.
You can, in a cake.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that was being brought out in your compare and contrast essay. Well, I copied that off the internet. Oh, we have our reading, Jesus Walks on Water. And I thought we would compare and contrast the record of this event as recorded in Mark and as recorded in Matthew. But then I found that I'd overlooked the record found in John also. Now you might have guessed the records are slightly different, hence the compare and contrast theme. Now I'm not trying to be controversial, saying one didn't happen and the other did, and I'm not going to speculate why they're different. And I don't want you questioning or reading anything into this, that there are differences. The feeding of the 5,000 is recorded in all four Gospels. So if you read them all, you get the fullest account. We know that John's record of the Last Supper is different to that of the other three Gospel writers. Each Gospel writer records the crucifixion differently. But all are clear that Jesus was despised, rejected, ridiculed, there on the cross suffered agony, and died. They all recalled his resurrection. I mean, two of us could go to the same event, witness the same event, one totally moved and awestruck, telling all it was fantastic, best thing ever, while the other reports, no, it's nothing special. I'm not sure it really affected me. Just a run-of-the-mill event. Compare and contrast. One description I read was, by understanding similarities and differences between two things, we can increase our understanding and learn more about both. Now, we're not doing an academic study this morning. It's more sort of on the face of it as we read and we'll compare. I'm going to give you a copy of Mark and Matthew's record. That's recorded. And I want this side to look at the Mark version and this side to look at the Matthew version. So, I'll put John's record on the screen. Hopefully that's covered it. I'll read out John's, and you, as you're scanning reading there, you tell me if it tallies with what you have in front of you. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. But now it was dark, and Jesus had not joined them. A strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. When they had rowed 3.5 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, don't be afraid." Then they were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached where they were heading. Let me ask you some questions. And I've checked in John, this event follows straight after the feeding of the 5,000, as does Mark and Matthew's. Who left in the boat? I'm asking you a question here.
The disciples.
Who didn't get in the boat at that time?
Jesus.
John tells us he went up a mountainside. Is that what you have?
Yes.
Yeah? Yeah. Good. Strong wind and waves? Disciples and boat Disciples and boat appear to be getting nowhere. That ring true?
Doesn't say.
I think it says they were toiling, doesn't it?
Yes.
Straining at the oars.
It just says buffeted by the waves.
Thank you. Jesus comes their direction, walking on water.
Yes.
John tells us the disciples were terrified.
Yes.
Yeah. Good. Then Jesus spoke, "It is I. Don't be afraid." Do you have something similar?
Yes.
Jesus got in the boat.
Straight away.
Yes. They got to their destination without any more incident.
Yes.
Yes. Did you have anything else? Don't tell me yet. John seems to be, when we look at it up there, to be sort of just narrative, telling the sequence, no application, you could say. I think if you do meditate on it, certain truths are still coming out. But in Mark and Matthew, it's more pronounced. So, as you've got a boat in front of you, and one side was Mark, one side was Matthew, we can compare and contrast that. If I sort of scan read it, Jesus dismissed the crowd up mountain to pray. Disciples struggling, wind against them. Time now was about the fourth watch, which I'm told is between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. Which, so it might have been twilight when some of these events were happening. Jesus walked. I think we have that on the lake. Terrified, they think it's a ghost. Jesus says, take courage. Put in boat. Wind and waves died down. Got to the other side of Gennesaret, where people recognised Jesus. Got that?
Yeah.
Anything else happened in Matthew's record? Somebody else walked on the water amidst the wind and waves. Someone going to tell me what happened to Peter?
He sank.
He walked off.
It looks like Jesus
wasn't there. Well, I've summarised it here. Peter talks. I think he actually asks. Did he come? Peter walks. Peter turns. His eyes off Jesus. We would use that phrase, wouldn't we? Peter sinks. Peter calls. Jesus summons. And Jesus says, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And we also read that the disciples worshipped him. Truly, you are the Son of God. Is that in Mark's version, because that's his record? Any of that?
Except the last bit.
Why this is in Matthew, this is about Peter, and not Mark, I don't know. It happened. It's recorded in the Bible. There's a salvation message there. There's a faith conundrum there. So I can ask you, have you ever tried to walk on water? Well, I've written down, I'm sure you have. I don't know if you're that sort of mind. If you've not tried, thought about it when you're on the beach and you're paddling as a child, teenager, adult, or grandparent, your grandchild. For you, did it happen? You meant to say no. And then I can say to you, are you of little faith? Why did you doubt? So what does it mean? You would like me to answer it, wouldn't you? But I'm not sure I can. But let me ask you this. Have you confessed with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believed in your heart that God raised him from the dead? You will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. And it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As Scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's from Romans 10, with some quotes from Isaiah 28, verse 16, and Joel 2, verse 32. And there's another phrase there, this is the word of faith. If that's you, you don't doubt, do you? Does that mean you have big faith? You then, as it were, walk on water to him who says, come. We're studying Mark. I say we could have just read that in isolation. Yes, we'd have known that Peter walked on water, but would we have put the two incidents together? I don't know. Would we have realised it was the same thing? In Mark, we have the disciples, terrified, bewildered, but also amazed. Then this self-diagnosis, let me get this in the right order. For they had not understood about the loaves, their hearts were hardened. We knew this phrase was coming, we referred to it before when we looked ahead at Mark 8. Jesus used the term hardened hearts to them when he said, do you still not understand? And he reminded them of the feeding of the 5,000 and 4,000. Here the phrase, their hearts were hardened, I think was in its mildest form. Still an issue, yes, but not terminal. I see it as then at that time, just simply not getting it. Their eyes blinkered, or the light bulb not turned on. They couldn't see the wood for the trees. They didn't see the bigger picture, but they would. It wasn't deliberate hardening or being cold-hearted, but taking of an approach that whatever someone said or did was not or never going to change their mind, stance, position or reaction. That heart could still soften, believe it or not. Think of Paul. But you don't have to be a Pharaoh or in a Pharaoh situation in the time of Moses when God hardened his heart. They had not understood about the loaves. They had seen the miracle. They took part in it. They'd seen the miracle worker. But using the term used a little later in the reading, did they recognise who the miracle worker is? In simple terms, compare and contrast, do we harden our hearts to him, or do we fall and worship him, saying truly, you are the Son of God? Yes, we might sing all the praise, his praise songs, but is it just words? Do we have a living relationship with the living God? Do we recognise him? Oh, that's him, as it were. Or do we really recognise him? Know him. He is God. He is our God. And accept him for who he is. Forget the miracles. Forget the fluff. Great is the Lord, for he says, it is I. The hymn asks, who is he? Let's compare and contrast. Jesus walked on the water, walked amidst the wind and the waves. When Peter cried out from his heart, Lord, save me, he did with outstretched hand. But when he got in the boat, the wind and waves ceased. We read Psalm 89, verse 9 earlier. You rule over the surging sea. When its waves mount up, you still them. It's not just poetry, it's fact. Why? Because of who he is. Who can take five loaves, two fish, give thanks, and share it out to 5,000 men, besides women and children. Who is enthroned in the heavens, sovereign Lord and Saviour, who has the name above every name, who took on flesh, became man Christ Jesus for his own, for the cross, but for the glory set before him, the gathering together of his own, to present them to the Father, the redeemed, his loved and his own. If we start with this understanding of who says it is I, and compare and contrast, then we know nothing compares to you. All our hymns expressed it, didn't they? Who Jesus is. What Jesus is. Who you are. What you are. Who made the earth from naught. Who, as it were, looks down from the mountainside. Who sees. Who hears. Who knows. Who understands the situation we are in. He did for the disciples. In summary, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper. The waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven. I've just been quoting Psalm 107. Verse 28 to 32. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? As if we were to compare that with Matthew and Mark and John's record. Why? Because it is I, who still says, take courage, and ask you, and ask us, do we recognise him? The psalm continues, and I'll finish here. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men. Let them exalt him in the assembly of the people and praise him in the council of the elders. Amen. Now we're going to sing, Who is He? But some new verses. The verses that could go in the middle of the original hymn. Perhaps we'll say you're a bit familiar with them. Let's go. I've written. Who is he who took some bread on giving thanks 5,000 fed? Who is he says courage take when fears arise upon the lake? Who is he midst wind and wave, with outstretched arm, did Peter save? Who is he took time to pray, met the needs he did survey? Who is he with faith-filled eyes, asked us believe and recognise? 'Tis the Lord, O wondrous story, 'tis the Lord, the King of glory. At his feet we humbly fall, crown him, Lord of all. We'll stand to sing.
Lord, let me know.
something to us. Let's sing this. Son and Holy Spirit, rest and remain with us now and for always. Amen.